For over 50 years, he was a constant presence on Britain's television screens. A reassuring host, the perfect master of ceremonies. A man whose face was so familiar, he felt like the nation's uncle. But he was also one of our finest stand-up comedians. A performer whose love of words and the crafting of a gag made him the most accomplished comic of his generation. Climb aboard for a whistle-stop tour of the world of Bob Monkhouse, a man who rose to become one of the great legends of British entertainment. A man who wrote jokes, sold jokes, told jokes, and loved jokes. A man who hosted more game shows on television than any other. Press rewind on TV's Time Machine to enjoy the best of the hardest-working entertainer Britain has ever produced. It's Bob Monkhouse, Master of Laughter. He was there in the 50s. The 60s.
Oh, that's better.
The 70s. The 80s. The 90s. And the noughties. Bob Monkhouse. A man who was such a regular on our screens that he almost seemed like part of the furniture of British pop culture. His was a stellar career that included writing comedy for some of the biggest stars in the world, appearing in movies.
Oh, Mary. Oh, I'm so relieved to see you.
Starring in radio shows, hosting game shows, but more than anything, he was a world-class stand-up comedian. Perhaps many of us knew Bob best from some of television's most popular game shows. He hosted more than a dozen different ones during his long career, shows that regularly topped the ratings, like Family Fortunes, Celebrity Squares.
Hello, celebrities!
Hello, Bob!
The Golden Shot.
It's a bagger! Win a bonus prize, and there it is.
And Bob's Full House. He hosted moments when the nation gathered around the television, like the National Lottery draw. All the time, using these shows as a chance to do what he loved doing best of all, telling jokes.
My wife has got to die. My God, I took her to the opera last week and nobody would leave until she sang.
Jokes were what Bob Monkhouse lived for. He would spend his days writing jokes, his evenings telling jokes.
My mother never wanted to have me. My mother never wanted me. When I was born, she was 39 months pregnant when I was born. putting it off. When I was a baby in arms, little baby, my mother tried to kill me. I'm sorry, it sounds serious, but I'm telling you the truth. She denied it, of course. She told the police she thought the plastic bag would keep me fresh. Oh, dear.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
He began writing jokes at the age of 15, performing them from the age of 20, and didn't stop for the next 55 years.
And I hate the stupid things that they say on aircraft. In the event of an emergency, put your head between your legs. My God, if I could do that, I'd never leave the house.
He once worked out that he'd written and told well over a million jokes in his career.
I used to go out with a woman nobody else wanted. I went out with a girl. I like a chubby lady. I love that. I admire ladies with flesh on them. My favourite sort of woman is a woman so big you can fondle her all night and never touch the same place twice. But this woman was so big. First time I had sex with her, 5 minutes getting on top. 5 minutes it took me, clambering on top. Then I started getting off. She said, where are you going? I said, I want to turn the light out. The bulb is burning my ass.
Bob Monkhouse's career as a stand-up comedian brought him awards and acclaim. But being funny was something he worked at more diligently and relentlessly than perhaps anyone before or since.
And you get characters, don't you, in the countryside, Richard? We've got a guy called Thumbs locally. He's called Thumbs because that's all he has. He has no fingers on his hands. He just has thumbs. So naturally, he's called Thumbs. People are very straightforward, not very sophisticated. We call him Thumbs because he's only got thumbs. Because he lost all the fingers off his left hand trying to get his fish paste sandwich out of a threshing machine. He took all the fingers off his left hand, and then he took all the fingers off his right hand, showing the farmer how he'd taken all the fingers off his left hand. And he would have taken the fingers to hospital and have them sewn back on, but he couldn't pick them up. He only has thumbs. He hardly plays the piccolo at all now. Well, he does, but it's awful. And he's taken up hitchhiking as a hobby, which is seems like a good idea, really. Except when the cars do pull over, he can't get the door open. Go on, go on.
Every word of every joke, every pause in every line, every gesture in every performance, all were meticulously honed before Bob went on stage.
You know the worst time for putting on weight? You know this. If you're a smoker and you stop smoking, boom, bound to happen. I know my wife smokes. She says it's a hobby, like stamp collecting. Do you buy that? Smoking is a hobby, like stamp collecting? How many stamp collectors do you know wake up first thing in the morning and go, where? Where are those damn stamps? I gotta have a lick now. This album is empty. There's gotta be a 19p commemorative somewhere in this bloody house. I don't smoke, but I can help you stop smoking in bed. If you smoke in bed, I can help you stop. All you have to do is two things. Buy a waterbed, fill it with petrol. This will work. It will work.
Monkhouse was a master craftsman, a super-skilled technician in the business of making an audience laugh.
I can honestly say that my sex life at 70 is just as great as it was when I was 69. I'm not going to lie to you. Last year, my wife gave up sex for Lent and I didn't find out till Christmas. I'm being honest with you. I'm being frank. It doesn't matter. A lot of us in this situation. I'm so pathetic in bed now, I pretend that I'm somebody else. That's all right now, you know? That's all right to pretend. If you, I read this in a magazine, one of my wife's magazines, that if you've been with the same partner for a long period of time, it's okay to pretend that they're someone else, if that helps you, if that increases everyone's pleasure. So I usually choose Michelle Pfeiffer. Don't tell my wife. Except the other night, in the heat of passion, I called out, "Oh, Michelle!" And she said, "Keep it up, Edith!" So I don't know what the hell is going on. I don't know.
Robert Allen Monkhouse was born on the 1st of June 1928 to a suburban middle-class family in Beckenham in Kent. Bob's father was a chartered accountant and his mother a gifted watercolour artist. His grandfather had started a company that made dessert foods, monk and glass custards and jellies. And the success of the business had brought the family financial security. But although it was a stable background, it was also a childhood of little warmth.
My mother was not a woman who was tactile towards her children, and I think there were only two occasions I can remember actually embracing me. What would the neighbours think would be a prime consideration in anything she did. Feelings were meant to be suppressed, not to be displayed. My father, he was a prematurely bald chartered accountant, somewhat given to parsimony, a glum man who showed me a great deal of affection when I was a tiny toddler. But less so as I grew up and viewed him more critically, I suppose.
The young Robert was privately educated at London's Dulwich College, where he began performing in school productions and writing jokes. Jokes he'd then tried to sell to comedians working the local variety circuit, including the great Max Miller.
The first person who ever paid me for a joke was Max Miller.
Right.
I stood outside the Lewisham Hippodrome, I think it was, and gave him a page of jokes. He paid me half a crown a joke. He said, "Give me something about the wife." So I gave him something about the wife. He said, "Give me something about the wife that's good, and you're into folding money."
The wife said, "Where are you going?" I said, "I'm going to Paris." She said, "What are you going to use for money?" I said, "Francs." She said, "Francs not going. What are you talking about?"
So I wrote him this bit that he used, Brixton Astoria. "I came home the other night unexpectedly, opened the bedroom door, and there was the wife with nothing on except the landlord. I said, 'Excuse me, dear. I'm always polite to her under these circumstances. Why are you making love to the landlord,' I said, 'when it's the butcher we owe money to?' Well, that's when she did something that hurt me." She said, "Sit down, Maxie, and watch. You might learn something." Well, he loved that, and he sent me a postal order for 15 and 6.
After national service in the RAF, the young Bob devised a cunning plan to land himself a BBC audition.
When I was in the RAF, I was doing RAF shows, and I thought, how do I get a BBC audition? At that time, I think the waiting list was something like a year. And I was working for a neuropsychiatrist in the RAF. I was his typist.
So I typed out a letter, as from him, to the BBC, saying I have a Corporal Monkhouse RA working for me, whose mental balance depends upon his getting an audition. So they wrote back to anything for our boys in blue. And I jumped the queue. The audition I did was on the day that the normal auditioner was ill. And co-opted to do it was a young producer who was quite ill himself at the time, overworked. He heard two artists, the late Gary Miller, a wonderful singer, to whom he accorded 100 marks out of 100, and me, who he gave 101. He then collapsed.
In the late 1940s and early 1950s, home entertainment meant one thing, the wireless. Radio was king, and with just three national networks to listen to, audiences were huge. Bob knew that if he could get to perform on the radio, it could be his first step on the road to stardom. In 1948, at the age of just 19, he made his first appearance on the BBC Home Service in a show called Work's Wonders, for which he was paid 8 guineas. From the time he was demobbed, the BBC put Bob on an annual retainer, and so began his performing career in front of a national audience.
But the man, do I look like a slob?
Oh, I wouldn't say that, Ricky. Oh.
No. But if I were you, I wouldn't walk within soaking up distance of a squeezed out dishcloth. That's
oh,
all.
Oh, very funny, Monkhouse. Very funny. You know, you could become a brilliant comedian. There's only one thing needed.
What's that?
A miracle.
By 1950, Bob was in demand for radio shows, but finding that his frequent appearances were eating up his material. He was approached by Dennis Goodwin, who'd also attended Dulwich College, who suggested they might team up to write together. The two collaborated on a first script and found the chemistry between them worked. And so together, they formed a new writing partnership. Before long, they were performing together too.
BBC Variety Parade.
For your enjoyment, we present the first of a new series, Hello Playmates, written by and including Bob Monkhouse and Dennis Goodwin, and starring Arthur Askey.
In the early 50s, Bob and Dennis were in such demand to write and appear in the top radio shows of the time that they set up their own business, the Monkhouse and Goodwin Agency. They were writing for up to 20 hours a day, delivering countless scripts for both other stars and to star in themselves. The 1950s saw a sudden growth in the popularity of television. The coronation was televised in 1953, and in 1955, Britain got its second television channel when ITV went on the air. Bob and Dennis realised that this new medium was the way of the future and began to write for television too. Their first series on television was Fast and Loose, which they wrote and starred in for the BBC.
Listen to breakfast.
For a delicious plateful of...
Cut!
I'm very sorry, Dennis.
It's a coincidence, so am I.
You were terrible...
The popularity of their television shows suddenly brought Bob and Dennis a new level of fame.
Delicious!
They were regarded by the viewing audience as a much-loved double act.
They really do talk. I can't wait to eat them.
Oh, crisp and crunchy.
Why don't you try Kellogg's Rice Krispies?
Let's have some more, and some more,
and some more,
and some more,
and some more,
and some more,
and some more,
and some more,
and some more, and some more, and some more.
While Bob's matinee idol looks and charismatic personality made him a natural on television...
You can call me Bob, or even better, you can call me after 6 o'clock.
Dennis Goodwin was never comfortable on the small screen.
Who's the script for?
Dinah Dawes.
Dinah Dawes?
Yeah.
Can I make some suggestions?
No, I'm sorry, all the suggestions are coming from me. I have a date with her to discuss it tonight.
A date, eh? I've heard about your technique with women.
It's nothing, really.
That's what I heard.
Despite his best efforts, he seemed ill at ease and awkward.
My partner gives renditions of popular records. For instance, he will now give you Debbie Reynolds' latest release.
Eddie Fisher.
Very good.
The contrast with Bob, who clearly felt entirely at home on television, could not have been greater. It was cruelly exposed in the BBC series My Pal Bob, where Dennis's role was consigned almost literally to the margins. He often appeared only in the corner of the screen, while Bob was front and centre of the show.
In the headlines, Bob decided to try cat burglary. If you think I'm going to use that old joke about who wants to steal cats, you're right.
Tensions in the relationship between Bob and Dennis were now beginning to surface.
I'm my own worst enemy.
Not while I'm still alive.
Just one more crack out of you, Patty.
Don't you strike me. I'm expecting...
While they continued to write together, some of the old magic in their partnership had disappeared.
You?
Oh, Bob, I've had...
Bob was being offered high-profile solo hosting jobs, like the game show For Love or Money.
For Love or Money, introduced by top television star Bob Monkhouse.
And while Bob's services were highly sought after, Dennis's were not. In 1962, their partnership ended when Dennis opted to move to Los Angeles to join Bob Hope's team of writers. He struggled to fit in with the already well-established group and returned to England, where his career never regained its earlier momentum. For Bob, the late 1950s and early 1960s was a period of back-to-back activity and professional fulfillment.
Careers may come and careers may go, but Monkhouse goes on and on.
In 1958, he was approached by producer Peter Rogers and director Gerald Thomas with an invitation to join an ensemble cast for a new British-made comedy film. It was to be called Carry On Sergeant.
So you know all about the Bren gun, eh?
Yes, Sergeant.
There it is, look at it. I've stripped it down for you, haven't I?
Yes, Sergeant.
Well, put it together again!
None of the cast of Carry On Sergeant realised at the time this would be the first of a series of Carry On movies that would be produced for the next 20 years.
Pardon?
Unlike some other cast members, Bob didn't want to commit to being part of a regular ensemble company. If he was to appear in films, he wanted a starring role.
Coxon, true or false?
I was just wondering myself, sir.
That opportunity came along in 1960, when Bob was invited to star in Dentist in the Chair, the first of two Dentist films, in which Monkhouse also contributed to the scripts.
I'm afraid that's going to have to come out.
I'm having the gas, aren't I?
Oh, no, there's no need for that.
I can't take the cocaine, you know.
Oh, no.
The sequel was Dentist on the Job. Later in his career, Bob lamented that by choosing the Dentist films over the hugely successful Carry On franchise, he'd probably backed the wrong horse. While he enjoyed appearing in movies, it was being a film fan that gave him his idea for his next big project, this time for television. Bob had become an avid collector of film prints, and his knowledge of movies and movie making bordered on an obsession.
Here's one of the greatest treasures in my collection. I found a complete serial, intact, all 21 reels of it.
He shared this passion with viewers in a new series he devised, wrote and produced himself, setting up his own production company to do so.
There were no set speeds in those days. The film went through the camera at whatever speed the operator cranked the handle.
The series set out to explain the process of filmmaking and celebrate some of the best examples from the earliest days of cinema. Its title, Mad Movies.
Here I am. I'm ready. Ready to jump from the sixth-story window of a New York apartment building in the great tradition of the Kings of Comedy.
Happy landing!
Well, those golden days are over, but they still cast their dancing shadows on your screen each time you focus in on Mad Movies.
Got it? Okay, fine, credit.
70 take one, not going in.
Oh, that's another Mad Movie show in the can, eh, Jeff?
Oh, boy.
Listen, before we go ahead and film the next show, do you mind if I take an hour's break to get something to eat? Oh, unless I could have it served right here on the set.
Alongside his work presenting on television, Bob was also now actively developing his parallel career as a highly accomplished stand-up comedian. This was what he loved doing most, standing on a stage, entertaining an audience with a well-crafted routine. By the mid-1960s, he was one of the biggest draws in the variety venues and working men's social clubs, which were then at their peak.
There is nothing like this anywhere else, Michael. Nothing at all, not quite like this.
You work terribly hard. Do you know any place where you work harder than this?
I suppose one works harder and longer in summer show or pantomime, but when you get out on a stage in a club like this, you've got to deliver. And you've got to be a pro, otherwise the audience will lose interest in what you're doing. But if you do deliver, they're the best audience in the world.
A lot of the material here seems to be very robust, to say the least. Very, very bawdy. Now, why is this, Dick?
I don't think it's bawdy. I think it's adult. I think this audience is extremely quick-witted, the club audience I'm talking about. I think they've had a load of, shall we say, disinfected pap from television for a long time, which they like very well in their own homes, but when they get together in a community, they want to hear something stronger, brighter, gayer, and a little bit more engaged to the adult taste.
Bob realized that to keep people buying tickets to see him perform live, he needed to maintain a regular presence on television. In 1967, he was invited to become host of the biggest entertainment show of the times, the London Palladium Show.
And it's eyes front for Bob Monkhouse.
This rare footage, found in Bob's personal archive, shows one of his earliest appearances.
Thank you so much. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Did you have a nice Easter? I love Easter because you get all the weddings, you know, and you see everybody trying to get married, you know, to beat the tax, and you see all those wonderful Easter bonnets. Oh, I saw at one wedding such a beautiful hat. It was in a kind of a blush pink organdy, and it was trimmed with full-blown roses and cerise, and it was on a sort of meringue of kingfisher tulle, and I have never seen Lionel Blair look lovelier in anything.
That same year, Bob learned that ATV had acquired the rights to a hot new game show, which had been a huge hit in Germany. The name of the show? The Golden Shot. Bob was desperate to host, but instead ATV booked Canadian singer Jackie Ray to helm the new show. Halfway through the series, Bob appeared on The Golden Shot as a guest and made such an impact that he replaced Jackie Ray as host just over a month later.
And now here's your host, Bob Monkhouse.
And so Bob took the reins of a show that was to become one of the biggest in his career, the start of a truly golden time. Every so often, a television show comes along that really captures the viewing public's imagination. And the show becomes a bigger hit than anyone ever expected. Between 1967 and 1975, that show was The Golden Shot, the first live, truly interactive game show on British television.
Here is your golden boy, Bob Monkhouse!
In its eight-year run, it became massively successful, regularly attracting some of the biggest audiences of the week. The show had an ingenious idea at its heart. A crossbow was mounted to the front of a television camera.
Who's on the firing line?
Harry Jones, working Gloucestershire.
A contestant, watching the live show from home and speaking on the telephone, would then direct a blindfolded camera operator manning the crossbow to fire a bolt at a target.
30 seconds. You ready, Nessie?
Yes.
Ready, Freddy? Starting now.
Up. Stop.
Sometimes, to make it harder, the targets were moving.
Down. Stop.
Left a bit. Stop. Right a bit. Stop.
And contestants only had a limited time to fire the bolt.
Fire. Fire.
And you blew it up, Harry. It's a banger. You win a bonus prize. And there it is. Yes, you did it. Oh. Yes, you did it, Brian. You get a tie, too.
Lovely. Thank you, Bob.
If a contestant was successful on the phone, they'd be invited into the studio the following week to fire a bolt live in the studio. The combination of a live transmission, real crossbows firing real bolts, pyrotechnics and trigger-happy contestants made for the ever-present potential of televised chaos.
Ah, oh, yes, I can see where it went, because it went right up there.
Fair.
Yes! Oh, more fair. More. Oh. We have a problem.
Yes.
Hold in. You press the button. Wow. Do you know, it wouldn't be the golden shot if something didn't go wrong.
Fire.
Oh! What have you done?
But as is so often in television, the more things went wrong, the more the viewers loved it. Bob was joined on the golden shot by Anne Aston.
They're trying to tell me it's safe, but I don't think it is.
Anne's job was to introduce contestants and add up their scores.
Well, Leslie has scored 84, less a penalty of 7, which is 84, 74, 75, 76, 77, 77, 77.
Come on forward and hear your score.
Well, this contestant has scored 110 on the high-scoring target. Well, it's got to be less a penalty of 40, which is 170.
It's just 70, not 170.
Her apparent inability to do either very well was more than compensated for by her charm and warmth.
I'm not as daft as you think, Bobby. You know, there's going to be no more getting my sums wrong because I've got myself a pocket computer.
Where is it, then?
Where is it? Well, it's in my dressing room. I forgot to get any pockets.
Get one for your brain. It's pocket-sized.
Bob proved himself to be ideally suited to this live format. For a start, it gave him the opportunity to open the show with topical comedy.
I'm still wondering where to go for the summer holidays. I haven't made my mind up. Year before last, on a holiday trip to Mallorca, my wife got pregnant. And then last year, on a week's trip to Blackpool, my wife got pregnant. So on future holidays, I'm going to take my wife along with me. Starting...
No!
She wants to be careful with that gun. She might blow her brains out.
You don't know her very well, do you? Your profession is what, Peter?
A plumber.
A plumber, yes. Do you work to assistant or are you lagging behind? Today I bring you the exclusive news that Elizabeth Taylor and Richard Burton are to try again. The winner will meet Muhammad Ali in the finals. Now the first contestant chosen from our big drum of letters.
She's Mrs. Margaret Farthing from Hadley near Ipswich, Suffolk.
Mrs. Margaret...
Farthing.
You're a farthing and I'm a bob. If we got together, it'd make a little change. Lovely name, Farthing. Your parents should have called you Penny. It's a name that opens a lot of doors. Now, what do you, you feel that joke go out and then slowly come back?
There was also a strong charitable element to the golden shot, with viewers writing in each week to propose worthy recipients of the prize money won by a guest celebrity. The whole show is a winning formula. But Bob's masterful tenure of the golden shot was interrupted in 1972, when he was suddenly fired by ATV. It was alleged that he'd accepted a gift from an individual who had supplied a prize for the show, and ATV's management swiftly terminated his contract. In the final live show before his departure, Bob could not hide his disappointment from viewers.
Today it's a time of mixed feelings for me, as you can imagine, mixed emotions. Like the old gag goes, mixed emotions is seeing your mother-in-law drive off a cliff in your new car. Well, that's the way... Remember that one? That's the way I feel today. For this is my last golden shot of 220-odd programmes. Over 4 years, it's the last time on a Sunday afternoon I shall say any of these words. And that makes me very sad. At the same time, I'm very thrilled to have had wonderful letters from you all and to know that the show will be continuing with an old chum of mine at the helm, but more of that later.
Monkhouse was replaced on the golden shot. First to take his place was Norman Vaughan, who seemed unsuited to live television.
It looks easy to you folks. I've been watching him today. It's very hard. It's not easy. I mean, you see, Bob, people get the wrong idea about me. They think that I'm very calm and cool and relaxed, don't they?
Yeah.
But you know that I'm... Oh! What's going on? What was that?
Good.
Really? So I'm a little bit, what can I say? I'm a little bit apprehensive.
And then by comedian Charlie Williams, who never really mastered the basic skills of hosting a game show. With the ratings for the show in freefall, ATV realised that the only way to save their golden goose was to bring back Bob as host. A new deal was done, and in July 1974, Bob made a triumphant return to the golden shot.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. It's like coming home again. It's just like my home, filthy and full of strangers.
The golden shot ran for another year.
I'm the sort of...
Hey? Oh, well. It's a bit loud, that, isn't it? It's a bit loud, isn't it?
Yeah.
Tough luck. He should have gone first himself.
£600. Can she do it? That pretty lady with the super trigger finger. Leslie, do you feel lucky today?
I'll try.
You've got 500, you've got that superb ring that you chose. Try and make it 600 before us all. £600 within 20 seconds starting now.
To entice Bob back to ATV, the company had agreed that after 12 months, he could host a new game show that his management had spotted in America. That show was Celebrity Squares.
Celebrity Squares, part one, take one.
Hello, celebrities.
Hello. Nine celebrities sat on a giant vertical noughts and crosses board for Celebrity Squares.
Who or what were the Wobblies?
They had to answer a question.
Now, they'll be very serious. Cartoons. Hollywood cartoons, eh?
And then the contestants simply said whether they agreed or disagreed with their answer.
I know money is won on that square and your opponent's naught goes in there.
If they were right, they won the square. And three squares in a row meant they won the round.
Ron, you've won the prize.
A straightforward game, and one that proved hugely popular with audiences. The show was able to attract some big-name stars to sit in the squares. Names like Hollywood's king of horror movies, Vincent Price.
How would you describe the taste of human blood?
Well, I tell you, the other day I had some southern fried chicken. And it was finger-licking good. And I bit my thumb. And I can tell you just exactly what it tastes like. Salty.
Tell
me. I think he's right.
I think he's salty too, so you win £10 just as the first order of the day.
And Bob also brought to the show a distinctly colourful sartorial style.
Hello, celebrities!
Hello, Bob!
Celebrity Squares also gave Bob the chance to jam in as many jokes as he could between the elements of the game.
I live at 6 Hurley Drive, Cheel Hume.
Oh, Hurley Drive? Bill Hurley of Hurley Drive?
Yes, they called it after me. I don't know why, but they named it after me.
They named a town after me, Leatherhead. What do you... Tell me, what does your husband do?
He's a resistor specialist.
A resistor specialist, so you have no children?
What?
Bob Monkhouse!
Celebrity Squares proved to be a big hit for Bob Monkhouse, and he hosted an incredible 138 editions of the show between 1975 and 1979. Despite the great success of both Celebrity Squares and The Golden Shot before it, Bob was keen not to be seen by viewers as just a game show host. He was still writing massive amounts of new comedy all the time. And during his hiatus from The Golden Shot, he made a series of comedy specials for Thames Television. A sketch written and performed brilliantly by Monkhouse in one of those shows demonstrates the level of his comedic ingenuity.
Good afternoon. My name is Detective Inspector Hector Vector. Oh. You are?
The Rector, Victor Proctor.
Mr.?
Doctor.
Dr. Victor Proctor, the Rector.
Also Director and Lecturer in Architecture, Sculpture, Scripture, Physiculture, and lastly, Past Headmaster. This is our matron and patron, Sister Lister.
Sister Lister.
Sister Esther Lister.
Sister Esther Lister. This is your son, Sister Lister?
I'm a spinster. This is Master Lester Foster.
Master Lester Foster, a correct inspector from Gloucester. My foster father was a pastor and an erstwhile plasterer from Bicester. This is a case of homicide fit for Ironside. Oh, oh, what a festering vista, blistered by hectoring invective. Oh, oh, oh!
Ah, there you are, Inspector.
Well, was your last case a routine burglary, as you expected? Get this down while it's still fresh in my memory.
First, the list of the cast in this Easter disaster consists of Master Lester Foster, fostered and sequestered by his spinster mater, the sister Esther Lister, erstwhile mistress of the past head master and rector, Dr. Victor Proctor, a bit of a twister, and seducer of the juicy Lady Brewster, from whose well-bolstered and upholstered chest she bequested the oyster cluster, niftily lifted from the canister by the banister, by Lester Foster, the subliminally criminal and similarly venomous, who, in an act of a pact which smacked of an act to extract a packet of substantial potential from the prudential, encrusted the pest infested pin in a butter-basted lobster pasty, but alas, administered a massive mass assassination with a noxious toxin for which there is no digestive or restorative nostrum. And list, I insist, last twist, lover's tryst, he kissed, her fist. There's the list, nothing's missed, I'm away to get blasted.
Alongside his television work throughout the 70s, Bob Monkhouse continued to maintain a full schedule of live performances as a stand-up comedian.
And now, here's more summer magic from Bob Monkhouse.
Despite the decade's turbulent economy, virtually every city centre in Britain had at least one huge cabaret venue. And this was their heyday. Some of the biggest could seat up to 2,000 people, like the Night Out Theatre Restaurant in Birmingham, one of Bob's favourite venues. He tailored his cabaret act to the adult clientele.
There isn't a married man here, not one in the entire place or looking in right now to our summer night out who hasn't come home at some time feeling like the bionic man. About to become one of the persuaders. Into the house, that last Guinness just beginning to work. Upstairs, clothes off, into bed, start sending out those little signals that all you married girls come to recognize. Oh, God, he's after it again tonight. Oh, I've got such a headache tonight. Now, listen to that. Listen, did you hear that? Instant recognition all around the room. We have come to accept it as a fact of life. Wives have headaches. Single girls do not have headaches. Did you ever in your life, fellas, meet a single girl with a headache? Well, so the single girl is yes, I will or no, I won't. Doesn't fool around with anodyne. But wives... Why do wives have headaches? Single girls don't. I've figured it out. It's something to do with a wedding ring. It causes a constriction in the third finger, left hand. The pain travels down the sciatic nerve and paralyzes the entire head. Now, if the headache doesn't work, don't worry. These girls, they're clever. They got plenty of lines. The children will hear. If you haven't got children, the neighbors will hear. Say, all right, let them hear. We hear them. It's their turn tonight, dear. You see what I mean, man? Be ready with an answer. When she says, oh, I'm too tired. You say, all right, you're tired. Who asked you to move?
As the 1980s dawned, Bob Monkhouse found himself yet again hosting a game show new to British television. Like Celebrity Squares, this was another game show that had already been a hit in America. It was to become one of the most successful game shows ever to run on British television. It was, of course, Family Fortunes.
Oh, thank you. Your applause has been recorded and will be sent on to less fortunate stars.
In America, the show was called Family Feud, but Bob successfully lobbied for a name change for the British version, feeling that the word feud was too harsh.
Our two families who come from a long way away to be here at ATV Studios to play which is Family Fortunes, it is. They have been selected from among thousands of applicants because they have those essential qualities. They have good looks, they have intelligence, they have a cheerful nature. Most important of all, they can pay their own expenses.
Bob regarded Family Fortunes as the best game show he ever hosted in his career. A rock-solid format based on family members guessing the popular answers to poll questions.
My wife, Mary.
Hello, Mary.
My son, John.
Hello, John.
John's wife, Mary.
Oh, another Mary.
And my son, Norman.
So we have two Marys here. Yeah. Lovely to see you, parents.
And John.
You ready to play Family Fortunes, John?
No.
Got Mary, Mary, and quite contrary.
Must be a canny man.
Yes.
I'm a canny man. That's what all the girls ask about me. They say, canny?
And of course, the families presented him with plenty of opportunities for jokes.
My mother had 24 children. I'm one of them.
Wow. Oh, you didn't have a nanny then. You had a shepherd and two dogs.
We did, yes.
What's your name again?
Neil.
What's your name again?
Neil.
Arise, Sir
Bob. Dale,
what do you make?
A machine operator. Make breeze blocks.
Make what?
Breeze blocks.
Breeze blocks?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I used to live in one of those. The draftiest flat you ever saw in your life, I lived in. Pathetic to see the children flying their kites in the kitchen. Here. What's your trade?
Oh, make bollards.
Bollards. You said bollards?
Yeah.
You're quite right. I'm not that interested in knowing what you mean. Let's play Family Corner. May I say right away, I realise it was wrong of me to describe last week's prizes as a load of old junk. Some of our contestants went away with some marvellous things, which is why this week we're left with a load of old junk.
While Family Fortunes continued to be a hit on primetime television, Bob maintained his non-stop schedule of live performances. Every summer in the early 80s, he'd appear in Star Cabaret at the Butlins' holiday camps, often travelling between the sites to appear at different camps throughout the week. They were lucrative engagements, but more importantly for Bob, they kept him working throughout the summer weeks in front of large, appreciative audiences in resorts like Skegness, Minehead, and Barry Island in South Wales.
It's been warm today. It's been warm all week. It was tragic, actually. I drove down through Wales. I saw a cow lying on its back trying to give itself a shower. It broke your heart.
He'd perform material he'd never used on television and even adopt a more physical performance style than he'd ever attempt on the small screen.
Everyone at the bar, could you look at me, please? Could you look at me, the customers at the bar? Thank you. Okay, bartenders, you can start stealing now. See... they've got to sell the man's. Oh, they've got the man's beer here. I can't drink the stuff. Banks's, which is the local one here in South Wales, Banks's and the man's is too strong for me. I come from a little county down in the south called Kent, and there we only drink Watney's Red Barrel. You can drink 19 pints of that and pass the breathalyzer. It's weak stuff. But here, the fellas are getting these pints down them. I can't believe it. I had a pint of man's beer tonight. I was halfway through it. I thought, what am I drinking this for? My head was going. It tasted like something you'd sit in for an hour to try and soak a tattoo off your ass. I can't do that. I can't take it for this. Fellas here who can drink that kind of thing, oh, I wish I could. And then they're nipping the gents. That's the finest room in the place. Do you know, there's a lot of talk in this country about the European Economic Community, the common market. Should we be in it? Should we come out of it? There's only one true common market. It's that humble little room marked gents. When you're in there, it doesn't matter whether you're German, whether you're Dutch or Danish, whether you're French, Belgian or Italian. When you're in there, European. And that's the only thing. Well,
in 1983, Bob made a surprise move that stunned the world of show business. After nearly 20 years of working exclusively on ITV, he was returning to BBC television. One of the attractions had been the chance to host his own talk show, a show devoted entirely to comedians and their craft, and the chance to deliver a monologue at the opening of every programme.
That's been a nostalgic experience, walking back into the BBC bar again after all this time. And I said to the lady behind the counter, I said, do you know something? It's been 20 years since I came in here. And she said, I'm doing my best. You'll just have to wait your turn. Oh, this I didn't like. On the tour, they took me to the medical department, and I could have done without that. I did not like that doctor. I did not take to that doctor. He was weird. He was definitely something wrong with him. He wanted me to grab him while he coughed. I thought, what's this? I don't want that. Weird, weird man. He said, what about a specimen? I said, all right. And he gave me one. Then he made me undress. He said, take off all your clothes and go down on all fours. So I did. And he said, crawl over by the door. So I did. He said, crawl over to the window. So I did. He said, crawl over in the corner. I said, is this necessary? He said, yes, I'm buying a coffee table and I can't decide where...
On the Bob Monkhouse show, he played host to the biggest names in comedy in the world.
30 years cannot have passed. You look wonderful.
I've been in makeup for 3 days.
He also introduced British audiences to rising stars from America, including a young Jim Carrey. The show also allowed Bob the chance to witness up close some of his comic heroes performing right in front of him.
Take a seat, Les. Wonderful to see you.
Wonderful. Greatest. How long does this show take in? It's like a bloody theatrical night shift. This is longer than How the West Was Won. I can't believe it. Oh, look at that set. Looks like an early Greek McDonald's. Say something, you're the host.
In addition to the laughs, the series was significant for a poignant reason too. It was to be one of the last appearances on television by Bob's great friend, Tommy Cooper.
What's this?
I've only just got this. It's only just arrived. I've got the instructions here.
A new trick?
A new trick, yes.
Is it new to you as well?
Absolutely brand new. It says here you receive a blank, a bit of wood, and two glasses, empty. And it says here, they'd be better when they're full. It says, pause here for a big laugh. And then, am I all right?
It's,
And it says, you get the wood and you hit it on your head. And you say, solid wood. Which not gets another big laugh. It says it's here. It says it's here. Then you get the glass, you put them upside down like that, you see? That's right. Like that. And then you put your hand there like that. Hold them there. Don't take your hand away, otherwise they'll fall down.
Right.
Well, everybody knows that, doesn't it? It's silly, isn't it? I mean, you know that, Bob, don't you?
Alongside his talk show, Bob made a return to Saturday primetime when he revamped a show made famous by Huey Green 2 decades earlier. Opportunity Knocks was the Britain's Got Talent of its day, giving aspiring hopefuls their big break on television and offering viewers the chance to vote for their favourite. Bob became deeply involved with the production of the show, embarking on grueling tours of auditions all over the country.
Brian Jones, at number 5 tonight, Brian Jones and Slenart in Dibbing.
The experience gave him memories that he would still recount many years later.
We saw some of the worst people I've ever seen who believed they could perform. Well, you think we put the garbage on TV, you should have seen what we turned down. Can I tell you about The Naked Man?
Yes, please do. This was an act, was it?
This was an act.
His act was to be naked?
There was slightly more than that,
all
to
right.
it. Not a lot more, I'm afraid. He was unhindered by talent of any kind.
Unencumbered. Unencumbered by talent.
But this was a freezing cold January in Glasgow in a big dance hall at 8 o'clock in the morning. And there's some poor woman auditioning for us playing Ramona on a saw or something. And I see the floor manager remonstrating with this small man who has apparently just taken his shirt off and is prepared to take his trousers off. And they went into the gents. And the small man reappeared in a raincoat. And he walked out onto the floor and he dropped the raincoat. And he was wearing very saggy old underpants and thick woolly socks. And he stood there. The rest of him was completely nude. It was like the scarred, lean body. And he sang, I Who Have Nothing. So my curiosity was aroused, and I followed him to the gents, and I said, what was that about? Do you mean to wear underpants and socks and sing I Who Have Nothing? He said, no, that's your man. He said, that's your man. That's your man wouldn't let me go in there nude. The whole point is to be naked. Your whole thing is that man has got nothing. He's got nothing because of this government. And it was a satirical point. And I wouldn't make it. He said, oh, no, you can't show your genitals on television, sir. I said, don't call me sir. I said, don't be a serf. I said, rise up, take your clothes off. He wouldn't do it. So that was the point. He made me wear underpants and I'll never forgive him for it. And I said, did he make you wear socks as well? He said, no, that was my idea. It's bloody cold out there.
During his time at the BBC in the 80s, Bob also scored another big hit with a game show that capitalised on the British public's love of bingo. Bob's Full House was a brand new format. The idea had been sent to the BBC's head of light entertainment through the post and was piloted as a show called Top of the Shop before being retitled and launched in 1984.
Oh, I like it here. I do like it here. I really do. I love doing the show. I love being back at the BBC. You know, the only thing I miss about all my years at ITV are the adverts. I tell you that I learned from TV commercials. You know what I learned from TV commercials? That no matter how good a product is today, it'll be even better a year from now when it's new and improved.
It ran for 6 years and regularly attracted audiences of 15 million viewers, making it the most successful game show Bob hosted in his career.
How do you get to work?
I cycle.
Oh, that's healthy. It keeps you figure, doesn't it?
Yes.
Got to be careful, though, because you don't want any accidents.
No, I have been knocked down by two buses and assorted taxis.
Oh, that's in Liverpool, of course. Now, you'd be all right in London, because you can go for days before you see a bus. But if one does knock you down, watch out, because there'll be another three right behind it.
As always with game show formats, Bob was on a constant lookout for the opportunity to jam in a gag or two at any time.
He's got Susan. Have you got a boyfriend?
Yeah, I've got Troy. He's with me tonight.
Troy?
Yeah.
Is that his name?
Yeah.
Oh, I can just imagine you saying, if at first you don't succeed, Troy, Troy.
At the beginning of the 90s, Bob returned to ITV.
You can take the 800, or you can try for this. Remember, if you fail at 1600, you'll fall back to 64. But if you succeed at 1600, this little lot will be yours to keep.
He became the host of game show The $64,000 Question, which audiences never really took to. And a bizarre new format called Bob's Your Uncle, in which newlyweds competed in chaotic games for the chance to win a car. Entertainment was now changing, and Bob's TV work was beginning to look formulaic and old-fashioned. He'd been a fixture on television for four decades and needed to reinvent himself. Question was, how would he do that? In the early 1990s, Bob Monkhouse's career was stuck in a rut. He was acknowledged to be the undisputed king of the game shows, but game shows were out of fashion, and the formats he was hosting were looking desperate.
Has everybody got their Bob's Your Uncle wristwatches?
Yay!
Well, we want to thank you for being such good sports, and when you come back to the studio, we have a top-of-the-range washer-dryer waiting for you. We never stop partying here, you know.
He was still in demand as a live performer, but the kind of clubs he played were disappearing, and a new wave of comedy had taken over. Bob knew he needed a reinvention, but how would he do that? The answer came in 1993, from an unlikely beginning. Bob published his autobiography, Crying with Laughter. Rather than a self-serving showbiz memoir, Bob had written a candid tell-all book, and the honest approach he'd adopted made it a sudden bestseller. Suddenly, people knew more about the real Bob Monkhouse. There was more to him than the slick performer they saw on television. Then came an even bigger opportunity to show a different side to Bob. TV audiences were used to seeing him hosting game shows, but had never really seen the full extent of his skills as a stand-up comedian. That all changed when he was given his own TV special, An Audience with Bob Monkhouse.
Thank you very much. I'm wearing a dress suit for this occasion because it is basically my working overalls and has been for 45 years, 50 years. These shirts are dress shirts. They cost a fortune to have hand laundered. You're in a hotel. They'll charge you as much as £10 to hand launder a dress shirt. And if you take it to the hand launder yourself, it's going to be £5. I'm not going to spend that. I'd rather give my shirts to charity, and I do that. I get my soiled shirts and I give them to an Oxfam shop. And they wash them, and they iron them, and they put them on a hanger. I go back next morning about 75p.
Across a whole hour, in front of a celebrity audience, he performed a comic tour de force.
Don't make me use it.
It was as if his whole long career as a comedian had been a preparation for this moment.
Is there anyone who has a question for me that they would like me to answer? And I see immediately my old chum Jeremy Beadle is waving at me. You are the king of TV surprises. So, have you got a question?
Well, I have, Bob, but I don't really want to ask it.
You don't want to ask it? Why is that?
Well, it's not my question. It was given to me by one of your researchers.
It was given to you. What is the question?
Well, I was told to ask you, which is better, comedy or sex?
That's a good question.
Yeah, but it's not mine.
No, it's not your question. Well, don't you ask it if you don't want to, Jeremy. No one has... No one has the right to force you to ask questions that you did not originate. Have you got an original question for me?
Thanks, Bob. Well, actually, can I?
Yes, please do.
Well, looking around me and seeing all these famous people in the audience, is there anybody here you wish wasn't here?
By a curious coincidence. Well, there's so many nice and kind, friendly people here. Barbara Knox.
Yes. Do you think show business puts extraordinary strain on a marriage?
Oh, yes. I think any job that takes you away from your spouse does that. I was away from my wife 2 years ago. Yes, 1992. For 12 weeks, 3 months abroad, and I got back to Gatwick, and I phoned her to say I'm coming home from the airport, and I picked up the phone, and it was shaking in my hand. And I thought, I'm afraid to speak to my own wife. And I put it down, and I tried to sort it out in my mind. And I realized I was afraid that she had made a regime for herself, a daily routine in my absence, and I wouldn't fit back in. And so I pulled myself together, and I spoke to her eventually. And she was so loving, she was so affectionate on the phone, that I drove home faster than I should have done. I stopped for some red roses and some pink champagne. That's how soppy I was feeling. And I got to my house, and the front door wasn't closed to me. It was wonderful. And sometimes we need these reassurances in our relationship. The front door was wide open to me, and my wife wasn't waiting downstairs for me, if you know what I mean. And it was a wonderful welcome home. Well, I don't want to go into details, but she was upstairs waiting for me. And if you follow what I'm saying, don't look as if you do. The front door welcomed me in, and my wife was... Well, I'll be specific, she was in the bedroom. I mean, she was on the bed. I mean, how clear do you want this? I'll spell this out for you. She was spread-eagled on the bed. Wrists tied to the bedhead. I said, we've been learning some saucy tricks. She said, we've been burgled, you stupid bastard. I'll tell you why sex does creep into my thoughts. Watching television, you cannot... Nature does this to me, Gabby. You watch it, David Attenborough, any program on animals, and they're all sexually motivated. That's all they're doing, eat and sex. You watch, do you see the one on mountain goats? Yes, then you saw those big mountain goats, the male mountain goats get about, I don't know, 30 feet from one another or something, and they run as fast as they can, they bam, they smash their heads together. Now, why? To get the woman, to get the female mountain goat. Bam! I can't even remember wanting sex this badly. Bam! I mean, I'd last one bam. Bam! Oh, that's it. That's okay. Oh, you take her. You take her. You're a bigger goat than me. You have a boy. Oh, boy. Huh. Tell her I got a headache. Birds have it bad. Birds. Chickens are lucky because if they lose weight, it doesn't show in the face. But... Birds. Golden eagles. Do you see that one? Golden eagles mating? No? It's fantastic. If you didn't see this, the golden eagle has to mate at a great height. The female and male fly up to above a mile. And they mate in flight, which means they can't fly. As soon as they connect, they can't fly anymore. So they drop like a stone. This is truth. And they have to complete the mating before they hit the ground. And it's not unknown for them to, bam, hit the ground and die. So committed are they to the mating ritual. Now, I don't know about you ladies, but I'd have thought about 30 feet from the ground, you'd consider faking it, wouldn't you? I thought as much.
An audience with Bob Monkhouse was a critical and rating success for Bob, and his reinvention was underway. His slower, more assured stand-up style worked for a performer of his age. And the self-deprecation and personal vulnerabilities that he used in his act had an endearing quality. The Monkhouse star seemed to be in sudden ascendancy again. This was confirmed when Bob was invited to spend a week guest hosting the coolest show on television at the time, The Big Breakfast.
I'm Gabby Roslin.
I'm not Chris Evans. I wish you'd get
me here.
I'll be the show host. You be the contestant. Right. Okay, watch this. You'll learn something.
Yeah.
And where do you live?
Huh? I'm homeless.
That's wonderful. Well done. And what do you do for a living?
I don't have a job.
Splendid, well done. And, your mummy and daddy, where are they?
They died in a threshing machine.
Oh, they have a wonderful Christmas. I really do. So you got the idea, Ben?
Yeah, I like
that's
that.
How
An appearance on Have I Got News For You showed how far Bob's self-reinvention had come. And in 1995, the BBC gave him his own weekly Saturday night series, all built around his ability to think on his feet as a brilliant stand-up performer. Bob Monkhouse on the spot used a question and answer format that worked so well on an audience with. Bob was able to draw on over 5 decades of writing and telling jokes. He seemed to have a gag for every possible subject.
Do we have a William Watts? William?
Hello, Bob.
Hi.
Recent events show that famous people are prepared to pay for sex. So, have you ever been with a hooker?
Oh, God, like I'm going to tell you on national television, right? Oh, gosh, I think everybody pays for sex. If you don't pay before, you pay after. But it's a great question. I wrote a book about prostitution. It got the Hooker Prize. Maybe you heard of it. And in it, I pointed out that the oldest profession is also the best profession in the world. Listen, you've got it, you sell it, you've still got it. That's a great business. And I once went to a prostitute for an estimate, that's all. But because why go to bed with a woman who has total contempt for you and is only doing it for the money? Good God, I get all that at home. lovely lady raising her hand.
Hi, Bob.
Hi.
If you could choose the circumstances of your own death, what would they be?
Of course, we've all thought about this. Some of you, I'm sure, would want to die in a blaze of glory, doing something heroic. I would like to die, if I had to choose, I would die like my old dad, peacefully in his sleep. Not screaming like his passengers. Have you heard of this? Have you heard of liposuction? The liposuction is where they actually literally suck the fat out of you. Well, she's burnt up 2 Hoovers so far, my wife. But they say it in the... I've only read adverts, and it says it's just like going to the hairdressers. So presumably you go along and you want your rear... to decrease, and you say, take a little off this side, please. A little off that side, please. Leave the parting in the middle, would you please? Sensual food. Do you know about this book? Sensual food. I made the mistake of buying it for my wife. It brought her alive. She's suddenly reading about this. She said, we've got to do this. This is where a man covers the woman's naked body with whipped cream and then licks it off. She said, let's do that. Well, I don't like whipped cream all that much. Makes me queasy. So I said, couldn't we try something else? So we discussed alternatives. Well, the salmon paste was out right from the start. She turned down practically everything Sainsbury's have to offer. She turned down the Branston pickle, she turned down the chutney, the Campbell's condensed vegetable soup, mainly on the grounds that fragments of it would lodge. And eventually she settled, not with very good grace, I may add, for the Marmite. 12 and a half jars, I'm not kidding. 12 and a half jars I smeared on her. She lay there, she looked like a giant twiglet. She said, well, start, so I started. I cleared the left arm completely. It's very filling, you know, that Marmite. That was so rich. I felt full, I fell asleep. She was up half the night in the shower scrubbing, apparently, in a foul mood. So when she caught me, few days later, eating a chocolate bar. Oh, he likes chocolate, does he? Then we'll do it with chocolate. And ever since then, about every 4 weeks, we've had this dreadful procedure. And not normal chocolate, that sickly white stuff. I tell you, friends, if I hear that call, the Milky Bars are on me once more.
On TV last year, you said you hated ventriloquists. Do you really hate them?
Oh, I did say that on Room 101. No, I hate ventriloquists whose lips move. The whole point of it is destroyed. I have to love ventriloquists. Well, my mother was a ventriloquist. My mother actually could throw her voice brilliantly. For years, I thought it was the dog telling me to kill my father. I think all mothers are ventriloquists. Mothers learn to be ventriloquists because of their children. You remember when you were a six-year-old kid and you're running wild in a department store and your mother would grab you and go, if you don't stop me, I'm going to murder you, and you go, oh. I started out as a vent. My very first act, when I was, 17, I carried a dummy and I did a vent act. It's hard to describe the act I did. How can I describe to you the act I did? Ventriloquism comes from the French word, ventre, which means the stomach, because in the old days, when they couldn't see your lips move, they thought that the voice was thrown from your stomach. And the only thing that can be thrown from your stomach is puke. And there's a perfect description of the act I used to do. They all laughed when I said I was going to become a comedian. Well, they're not laughing now.
As a stand-up comedian, Bob was now working at the very top of his game. He made a conscious effort to tell jokes against himself more often. Now in his late 60s, he was so comfortable in his own skin that even his advancing years offered a rich new seam of comedy to mime. It was something he particularly relished doing in front of adult audiences at his live performances.
A man when he reaches a mature age is not driven like a maniac. But you guys, young guys, at the age of 18, for example, your sperm count was 500,000. Did you know that? At the age of 18, you're at your sexual peak. And your sperm count is 500,000. I had a sperm count 7 weeks ago. The doctor told me I was down to 3. And 2 of those have got arthritis. I try to stay lively. A man must. You know, sex is not a spectator sport. It's a contact sport. You've got to stay lively. If I have any message for men here, it's don't worry about age. My God, it doesn't matter. You can still... if you try. I like to stay modern. I like to have a mirror in the bedroom. When I make love to my wife, have a mirror in the bedroom. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Stick it under her nose, see if she's still breathing. Because my wife's not as keen on it as I am, I'm being very honest with you. She's about 10 years younger than me. She feels old age creeping up in her whenever I can manage it. She's not as keen. But I stay very, very lively. You've got to keep the stamina going. Do you know, I made love to my wife. Forgive me being so personal with you, but I'm telling you the truth now. I made love to my wife. It was a Saturday night, March the 28th, I think. It's in the diary. I mean, considering the age I am, listen to this. I made love to my wife for 1 hour and 3 minutes. I'm not kidding you. I'm not talking about wimpy hand-holding. I'm talking about passionate, ardent lovemaking. That's what I'm talking about. Ooh, I'm talking about the real thing. For 63 minutes. It's absolutely incredible. It's not a joke. I just had to tell somebody. Thank you. Well, thank you. Thank you for your applause. For those of you who didn't applaud... all right, it was the night we put the clocks forward, but... that's not the point. That's academic.
By the mid-1990s, there were only a handful of big cabaret clubs left in Britain, but Bob still loved performing in them. His live work allowed him to recalibrate his act to perform material suited to the club environment. and to experiment in how far he could manipulate an audience.
What's the difference about performing in a club? Is it a bluer act, a crueler act? Who do you laugh at?
Needn't be all that much bluer. It can be blue, it can be a brilliant blue. I don't like using four-letter words. I don't like using easy laughs, which crudity can sometimes win you, but I wouldn't want to win those laughs. It's an easier... your relationship is one-on-one with your audience. It's a sociable setting you're in. They have certain expectations that you're going to fulfil, but others that they don't know you're going to fulfil, subconscious ones, perhaps. You're going to choose the range and pace and method by which you entertain them, and you're in charge for that hour and a half. And there is no high in the world that I know of, never having experimented with the ecstasy or other drugs, as great as that great big laugh that you get from saying something to an audience that you only thought of 10 minutes before you walked out there. Wonderful. Lorena Bobbitt, coming to... She's visiting Britain. Snip, snip girl comes to Britain. Snip, snip girl. This is the girl. This is the lady whose husband made unnatural demands upon her. So while he was dozing off, she took the scissors and... Remember this? I didn't think that was so bad, but she chucked it out the window. That... I mean, that's littering, isn't it? Anyway, you go, that's littering. I mean, that's against the law. I mean, have a good time, but pick up after yourself, for goodness sake. Throwing a penis out the window. Anybody could come along and tread on that. Well, twist your ankle on that, you could. And what would you say when people said, how did you come to twist your ankle? What did you say? Trod on a penis. Your own? I wish.
On television, Bob was now back as a regular fixture in primetime entertainment. Hosting Saturday night's live national lottery draw allowed him to present up-to-the-minute topical gags to a huge viewing audience.
You can see the pictures from France. Miles and miles of queuing lorry drivers. And the fellow who lives next door to me said, it's just like your house when you're away working, Bob. I thought, hello.
Bob's status as the elder statesman of British comedy was confirmed when the British Comedy Awards presented him with a Lifetime Achievement Award for comedy. And then, in 1998, the BBC marked the occasion of Bob's 70th birthday with his own television special. It was, of course, another opportunity to reflect on his advancing years.
The thing to do, refuse to surrender to old age. Now, my role model for this is my Aunt Edith. My Aunt Edith is 88 years old. She's still driving. Not with me, I'm not completely insane. You wouldn't know anyone was in the car. I mean, she shrunk. I had to look her up close to see her. She's only this tall now. People in Sainsbury's car park saying, stop that Vauxhall, it's going to run away. It's a Jeremy Beadle stunt. No. All you can see is red knuckles and a bit of white hair. She drives to an old person's restaurant. They do a very nice large print alphabet soup. 88 years old, and she still makes me laugh, mainly because of the way she wears her stockings. She rolls them up to just above her knees here, and she can't get them any higher. She stops when they're there. And that was all the fashion. When she was a girl in the 20s, that's what they did. And then her local shop stopped selling stockings, and she had to start buying tights, and she still only rolls them up. So there's a little hammock, in there. She keeps Reader's Digest in there. A selection of fresh fruit. And she's waddling around her flat like this. Oh, would you like a grape? No, I wouldn't.
ITV marked Bob's 70th year by inviting him to make a special as a guest speaker at the prestigious Oxford Union, where he shared the benefit of his accumulated wisdom with the student audience. Bob clearly enjoyed playing to a crowd whose average age was a full half century less than his own.
You know, there are too many thickos in the world.
I will not suffer them gladly. Why is it whenever you stop a car and ask directions, you always get a thicko? You know, people who are thick ought to be made to wear badges that say, I am thick. Then you wouldn't bother them. You'd say, oh, excuse me, I want... Oh, no, it's okay. The waiter who comes up to you in the restaurant says, would you like to see a menu? No, I'd like to guess what you've got by the stains on your shirt. Your battery goes flat in your car and you're waiting for somebody else to come along. A car pulls up alongside you and you say, do you happen to have jump leads? And he says, why, is your battery flat? No, I want to clip it to my testicles and confess on the spot. People say such ridiculous things to you. I was in a taxi not a month ago and the taxi driver said, don't worry, Gov, I'll have you home before you know it. I don't want to be anywhere before I know it. Particularly home. That's senility, isn't it? Where am I? You're home. I don't know. People say things to you like, you're not yourself today. The next time somebody says to you, you're not yourself today, say, then why are you telling me?
Shortly after entering his sixth decade in show business, Bob took on a new challenge, hosting a daily game show produced in high volume. Wipeout was a fast-moving game that quickly became one of the most popular shows on BBC One's daytime schedule, attracting a large and loyal audience.
It's goofy fun for everyone.
For Bob, it was a dream job, a game show with a high turnover of jokes, which showcased his talents on television every single weekday.
I got home and I looked in my tropical fish tank, in my aquarium, and there, floating belly up, was a little golden corpse. Aww. And my personal favourite, too. I really loved that hamster. So I took him back to the pet shop, and I said, what do you think was wrong with him? Was he sick? And the man said, oh, he said, did he have a yellow stool? And I said, no, just a little wheel and some straw. So... yes, apparently they can die from a lack of vividly coloured furniture.
But Wipeout was produced in batches of up to 100 shows at a time, recorded at a rate of 5 shows a day. A demanding schedule, but Bob relished the challenge. Then, in September 2001, Bob was undergoing a routine medical examination when he was presented with some devastating news. He was diagnosed with prostate cancer. News of Bob's illness broke in the press, but he approached it in the way that came most naturally to him, with humour.
I can't stop the cancer, that's incurable, but I can control the way I look at the cancer, and I think the best way to look at it is see the funny side of it. So, inevitably, when they told me my PSA, that's the prostate, my prostate had gone off like a firework and distributed all these tumours all through my system, they're all in my bones. Spinal, about 40 to 45 of them I had. And so he calls me and he tells me this, the specialist. So here's the joke. I said, how long have I got to live? He said, 10. I said, what, months, weeks? He said, 9.
Wow.
Yeah,
it's not bad, is it?
Anyway, he said, are you prepared to give up 50% of your sex life? And I automatically, I said, which half, talking about it or thinking about it?
Characteristically, Bob used his cancer diagnosis as yet another opportunity for jokes. He appeared in his first Royal Variety performance back in 1957, at the age of 29. He'd been invited to perform by Royal Command many times in the subsequent decades. But now, 45 years after his first, he was back.
Thank you very much indeed. It's lovely here, isn't it? I feel great. I feel wonderful, and one or two things in the newspapers are rather discouraging about me, about my health. But people believe anything. I passed our local undertakers, and they had my picture in the window. And it said, coming soon. But I am healthy. I am healthy. I am wealthy, and I'm doing fine. Thank you very much indeed for that patter of indifference. I may say, I'm still enjoying sex at 74. I live at number 76, it's no distance. That's not true. I would
I would never be unfaithful to my wife for the very simple reason that I happen to love my house. And I would never... let her down. We, not that I've seen much of my house lately. We've been away a lot. We were in... we flew Concorde to Barbados. Concorde, oh yes. Very stylish. They have real silver cutlery and a little porcelain cruet. We haven't even got that at home. Well, we have now, obviously. My religious upbringing. I always had a fear of biblical stories, like that of the four disciples, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, who set forth to spread the word of the Lord upon the face of the earth. And it was Matthew who came out of the wilderness and there beheld a shepherdess upon a hill where she was tending her flock. And he went forth unto her, and he spake unto her, verily. And he said, I am spreading the gospel. He said, my name is Matthew, who are you? And she said, Tonight, Matthew, I'm going to be Britney Spears. But the power of prayer is apparent to our world leaders. Mr. Putin in the Kremlin, on his knees. Lord, I require answer to question. Please tell me, when will my great country rid itself of its economic problems? And he heard the voice of the Lord in his head saying, in the year 2050. And he said, I don't expect to be around that long. And in the White House, George W. Bush on his knees, Lord, Lord, when will my country, the great U.S. of America, solve its awful energy problems? And a voice in his head, the voice of the Lord, said, in the year 2060. And George Bush said, I don't expect to be around that long. And then 10 Downing Street, Tony Blair said, Lord, it's Tony. Must know, when will Britain see the end of its problems with the NHS and the roads and the railways and education? And in his head, he heard the Lord saying, I don't expect to be around that long.
After Bob's triumphant return to the Royal Variety performance at the end of 2002, and despite his ongoing health problems, his insatiable appetite for work remained undiminished. He began filming a short series for the BBC about some other comedy heroes he had worked with, but he was aware that his illness was making the work more difficult. His cancer was being treated, but it wasn't in retreat. In July 2003, he invited young comedians he admired to a basement comedy club below the Albany pub in London's West End. The plan was to share with them a few memories of his comedy idols for use in the BBC series. What it turned into, though, was Bob's final act, a comedic swan song in front of the next generation of comedy performers. Those present included David Walliams, Kevin Day, Fiona Allen, Junior Simpson, Reese Shearsmith, and me, John Coleshaw.
This is, as you know, this cellar is a Fred West franchise. And... oh, God. That's a... Hi, Kevin. That's as vile as I get. I stayed overnight last night in a London hotel. You like me, when you get to a hotel room, is it your domain? It is, for me, it's paid for. This is where I live. This is my kingdom for the period I'm in it. I like to sleep in the nude. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that, do you? And I'm lying there, naked on the bed. And the chambermaid walks in, finally. I think sleeping in the nude is a perfectly natural... I can't... Well, maybe you shouldn't do it on those long flights, but... I'm not a good flyer anyway. I can never get over when you get to the airport and they have luggage shops in the airport. Who arrives at the airport with his arms full of underwear? Oh, thank God, cases.
Bob approached it without melancholy or bitterness, but with the eagerness and enthusiasm of a performer a third of his age.
I have had a sex life, just in case you... I mean, don't look at me with too much pity. As a lad, I was fat and plain and pimply. I couldn't strike up a conversation with a girl of my own age. And I devised... it sounds ludicrous now, but I thought it would work. There used to be a sort of a bar on the way through to a dance hall where I lived in Beckenham, Kent. You probably know I come from Kent. I hear people mention the word. They mutter it as they see me. And I managed to get a set of six industrial-strength magnets, very powerful little magnets, like little heavy polements, and I sewed them in a sort of semicircle around the fly of my trousers, and I posed on a stool not unlike this one, thus, hoping that a girl would pass by on the way into the dance hall wearing a lot of rings on her fingers. Entering my field of magnetic attraction, you understand, her hand would, inadvertently and uncontrollably, fly into my fly, as it were, and we could strike up an elegant conversation based upon... Not a bad scheme. Well, I must have been looking that way when this short man with braces on his teeth came by. He still writes. I had an affair with a lady optician once who drove me mad in bed. She kept saying, is it better like this or better like that? Is it better?
What the audience in that small basement club didn't know, but Bob probably did, was that this would be his last stage performance. In addition to his comedic masterclass, Bob took the chance to reflect publicly in front of other comics on what it was to be a comedian, and offer his insights and memories on some he'd known well.
So you see, this was my living for 55 years. And I am a gag merchant, but you see, you know, my heroes have always been comedians. They've got to be people that you admire without reservation. And I grew up watching the great comics of variety theatre. And you know, Max Miller, when you can't see him on film, it doesn't happen. His eyes actually twinkled. Those blue eyes actually, they were hypnotic. And the great ones, Max Wall, Jimmy James, eventually Morecambe and Wise, set up a world of their own comedy and said, you can come in if you want to, but otherwise, we don't need you. And you had to go into their world that they'd invented. And that was The Goons, and that's, of course, The League of Gentlemen, and that was Monty Python. Wonderful gift to be able to do that, to create a world of illusion, of fantasy, and hypnotize your audience so that they can't do without you.
Bob also took the opportunity to share a story about a comedy legend whose eccentric ways could sometimes shock as well as amuse.
I was asked about Tommy Cooper. Oh, God, I love the man. He was just a naturally funny, sweet, goofy, violent madman. We were in London once, Tom and I, and I was at Euston Station. I was going to get a taxi, and he said, oh, you don't bother with that, on the tube. I said, well, you know, people recognise you, Tom, and they might clock me, and that could be, you know, a bit of a nuisance. He said, oh, we're not in London. And he was quite right, because if you do that in Birmingham or Manchester or Carlisle or where, people are going to clock you. But in London, they'd ignore you. I never understood this. So we went on the tube, and we're sitting there chatting on the Underground, and this beggar came on, a disgusting-looking man, filthy, dirty, horrible man, with an awful mongrel under his arm going... I mean, really a revolting sound, and need food or something around his neck on a horrible notice. And he's going along the Underground, and he's picking up money from people with a dog. And he gets to us, and Tommy's talking to him about something quite important. And he looks up, and this guy says, I'm starving. And Tommy said, eat your fucking dog. I never admired him more.
Thank you very much. God bless you all.
Less than 6 months after his last live show, Bob Monkhouse died peacefully in his sleep at his home in Bedfordshire. He was 75.
How would you like us to think about you?
You know, I'm not sure I want you to think about me. Most of the people for whom I worked as a young man as a writer are forgotten now. Forgotten comedians, they're forgotten fame. Fame is an addiction, stronger than most. And it's very passing, once its usefulness is ended. No, I think I'd just as soon be forgotten.
But almost two decades after his death, Bob Monkhouse has not been forgotten. His legacy is a six-decade career of creating laughter and entertainment for millions. An adulthood dedicated to lightening the load of daily life by inducing a diverting laugh.
I used to go out with a French girl. She was half French. She was half French, half English. Weird girl, shaved under one arm.
He remains one of the giants of British entertainment from the second half of the 20th century and into the 21st. He's still referred to as the king of the television game show, but more than that. He was perhaps the hardest working, the most industrious, and certainly one of the finest exponents of the craft of stand-up comedy that Britain has ever produced.
I try to maintain a youthful outlook, you know, do things that younger people do. And quite recently, my wife and I went to an Ann Summers shop. Do you know? See, I don't know this Ann Summers, but I reckon she's up for it, don't you, Philip? And they sell a wide variety of martial aids. And you've got to be young, you see. You've got to be prepared to try these things. Like, I get those condoms that are ribbed for extra pleasure. I wear them inside out, to hell with them. The stuff they sell in those shops is utterly breathtaking. Edible underwear. Do you know about this? It's underwear, it's women's underwear, and it's edible. And my wife said, we should try that. Yeah, sure. I don't eat her cooking, I'm not eating her knickers. I know about bad cooking. Excuse me. She made me dinner the other day. I gave it to the dog. He licked his ass to get the taste out of his mouth. They think there's a product in there. I think it's from Germany. It's called Mr. Swell Guy. And a man's supposed to take this stuff, it's like cream, and he's supposed to rub it on his reproductive organs, and it says it will make them much bigger. Oh, would it make his hands much bigger? I mean, it shouldn't be too difficult to figure out who's using this junk, should it? Walking around dragging his knuckles on the floor behind him. Good Lord. Vibrators, they've got these various vibrators. They say, oh, they're for your neck. Oh, sure. 35 horsepower rope starter. Shake the fillings out of your head.
They're not shoddy goods. They're beautiful artifacts. You know, they got them in gold and silver and onyx and ivory. And my wife said, I want the red one. I said, that is the fire extinguisher. Don't even ask the man. Oh, she's been spoiled. But you see, there's no doubt. It's been wonderful spending this celebration with you, and I hope you've enjoyed it at home. You know, it's been said that the comedian does more for society than the politician, the lawyer, or the scientist, but let's not get things out of perspective. You can get an exaggerated idea of your importance if you're not very careful. No one on his deathbed has actually ever said, I think the end is near. Send for a comedian. No airline pilot has ever told his passengers, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry to tell you that both engines are out. We're about to crash into the ocean, but thank God we have a comedian on board. I don't think you'll ever hear a government minister on Question Time saying, the Middle East crisis deadlock, it must be tolerated no longer. Send in the clowns. I don't think it's likely. The modern comedians, I find most of them pretty good. Although they will insist that they've made up certain phrases, that they've originated phrases, which they haven't. They think that they're the first ones to say, give it up, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, here he comes. Give it up. Give it up. People were saying to me, give it up 50 years ago. Well, I'm glad I didn't. Bye.